Woe unto them that call evil good, and good evil, that put darkness for light, and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet, and sweet for bitter. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes, and prudent in their own sight. Woe unto them that are mighty to drink wine, and men of strength to mingle strong drink, which justify the wicked for reward, and take away the righteousness of the righteous from him. Therefore, as the fire devoureth the stubble, and the flame consumeth the chaff, so their root shall be as rottenness, and their blossom shall go up as dust, because they have cast away the law of the Lord of hosts, and despised the word of the Holy One of Israel.
What we have learned so far about the Christian religion is that even when they sin, they don't sin. The fact of the matter is, Christians are above the law because they have no sin anymore. The blood of Jesus has covered their sins, past, present, and future. Certainly, if God Himself, the Great Almighty, who knows all and sees all, does not see their sins, then those sins cannot possibly exist. Christians preach that their sins are not imputed, and this is why there is no law for the Christian. For you see, without the law, sin is not imputed.
For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law.
Christians preach that the blood of Jesus takes all of their sins, even the ones they haven't committed yet, and makes them white as snow. The following is one of the favorite quotations by Christians.
Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool.
This magic transference of your sins from darkness to light is based on the legal fiction of imputation. This is where our sins were transferred magically to Christ as he hung on the cross, and yet he still managed to die as a lamb without spot or wrinkle, and as a result of his death, our sins died on the cross. Then, in another magical transference, all of the righteousness and holiness of Christ was magically transported onto us when we say the sinner's prayer. We are imputed righteousness, even if we are murderers and adulterers in our daily lives. Sin is now righteousness under that system. Sins are white as snow. It's not that we actually become white as snow. Oh no, that isn't even in their gospel. No, we are just counted white as snow. It's not that we are just and live just lives. No, we are counted as just. They completely rip Isaiah 1:18 out of context. When we read before and after it, we discover that their sins will be white as snow because instead of doing those sins, they will be doing righteousness and obedience instead.
Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doings from before mine eyes, cease to do evil, learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless. Plead for the widow. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword, for the mouth of the Lord hath spoken it.
Christians deny this completely, saying instead that the righteousness of Christ is transferred to them or imputed without them doing anything just or righteous.
Now the question is, on what possible grounds could God ever say to you, you are just, when in fact you are not just? Again, how can an unjust person be justified? That God, in Christ, Christ willingly takes upon himself all of this. So that before God, once the sin has been imputed to him, and again, we'll talk more about what this means when we examine the curse motif in the New Testament, but now in the sight of God, God looks at Christ, and what does he see? Justice? He sees a mass of sinfulness because the sin of now has been transferred to Jesus. This is elementary. I don't want to be insulting your intelligence, but this is, we've got to get this into our bloodstream. The sin is transferred or imputed to Jesus. Now, if that happened, and that's all that happened, the single transfer, the one-dimensional transaction, you would never be justified. If Jesus took all of my sins that I've ever committed on his back and took the punishment for me, that would not get me into the kingdom of God. All that would do would be keep me out of hell. I would still not be just. I would be innocent, if you will, but still not just in a positive sense. I have no righteousness of which to speak. And remember, it's not simply that the innocence that gets me into the kingdom of God, it's righteousness. Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you'll never get in to the kingdom of God. And so we could talk about, maybe I'm not guilty of anything, but I haven't done anything. I haven't merited anything whereby justice would give a reward. So the point is that there is a double transfer. Not only is the sin of man imputed to Christ, but what happens to the righteousness of Christ? The sin is transferred to Jesus. The righteousness of Christ is transferred to us, to our account, so that in God's sight, this circle is now clean.
It should be noted that imputation of righteousness is largely regarded as a Protestant teaching. Catholics denounce it, and Protestants are quick to point this out.
So that God, when he declares me just, is not lying. Incidentally, Rome has trouble with this. Rome calls this concept, the Protestant concept, a legal fiction. And they recoil from it because they sense that in the Protestant view of imputation, that somehow this concept casts a shadow on the integrity of God, because God is now declaring people just who are not just.
Catholics say they just preach infusion rather than imputation, whereby we as believers become righteous and are not just counted as such. This is, however, not borne out in their doctrine. Catholics have the Holy Eucharist, in which a believer must partake in the body and blood of Jesus. This imputes them with righteousness, even though they are born sinners, original sin. Catholics teach that even though you completely walk away from personal sin, you are still an imputed sinner because of your relationship to Adam. This is original sin. In the Catholic Catechism, it states quite clearly that just as in Adam all are sinners, imputation of Adam's sin to you, even so in Christ all shall be made righteous. 402. All men are implicated in Adam's sin, as St. Paul affirms, by one man's disobedience many, that is all men, were made sinners. Sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men, because all men sinned. The apostle contrasts the universality of sin and death with the universality of salvation in Christ. Then, as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all men, so one man's act of righteousness leads to acquittal and life for all men. As we have just read straight from the Catechism, just as all men are counted sinners because of Adam's sin, all men are counted righteous by Christ's righteousness. This is, in fact, imputation of righteousness, whether modern Catholics want to admit it or not. During the justification of Eucharist, it is this original sin imputation that is cited as the purpose and necessity of the body and the blood of Christ. For Catholics to deny they preach imputation, therefore, is preposterous. 1325. The Eucharist is the efficacious sign and sublime cause of that communion in the divine life and that unity of the people of God by which the church is kept in being. It is the culmination both of God's action sanctifying the world in Christ and of the worship men offer to Christ and through him to the Father in the Holy Spirit. In the last video, we looked at a clip of a Christian preaching that grace teaches you to live a righteous and holy life, while at the same time, preaching forgiveness of future sins through the blood of Christ. Catholics do the exact same thing. They claim to believe in infusion of righteousness rather than imputation, while at the same time establishing the Eucharist and elaborate systems of confession for future sins. Confession of continual sins is built right into the Catholic system. They cannot truthfully claim that they believe in walking perfect, righteous, and holy. They merely call imputation infusion, but it's the exact same concept whereby the death of Jesus Christ cleanses you from all unrighteousness, even future unrighteousness. The only difference between the Roman system and the Protestant system is that the Protestants reject Roman system whereby this imputation is obtained. So when Roman Catholics say they don't preach imputation, but rather infusion, what they're really saying is that your sins cannot be made white as snow without their Catholic system. It has nothing to do with infusion of righteousness and everything to do with infusion of Catholic law and tradition in order to be imputed as righteous. Catholics do not believe they are perfect, and they do not believe that God expects perfection. So I submit they're playing semantics. The Catholic infusion of righteousness is imputation with religious strings attached. The end result, whether we are talking infusion of righteousness by the blood of Jesus Christ or imputation of righteousness by the same blood, is that your sin is no longer sin. The Protestants preach that all you have to do is believe in Jesus and make a positive confession, and you are now righteous no matter how many sins you committed or how many you will commit. While the Catholics preach that one must remain a Catholic and partake in the Eucharist regularly and participate in the church sacraments and in holy confession in order to be imputed as righteous. They call this infused. The end result is still the same. The Christians' sins are not sins. Catholics vehemently deny imputation, pointing to Article 11 of the Council of Trent, which denounces it. However, all one need look at is infant baptism to see that they're playing both sides. An infant cannot cooperate with the Holy Spirit in a fresh infusion of righteousness into its life. Nevertheless, upon baptism, the baby is imputed as righteous and is considered clean of original sin. All the claims to the contrary of imputation by Roman Catholics is not borne out by their doctrines, and infant baptism is the most stark reminder of this. Catholics will inevitably argue that a newly baptized person is not just seen as justified, but is in reality justified by his or her repentance. Thus, they are playing on semantics. Do they believe that a newly baptized baby is suddenly sinless and perfect? Of course not. Nevertheless, this baby who has not yet learned obedience in the Holy Spirit is now justified. They call it infusion and deny its imputation, but it most certainly is. Protestants don't teach that the Christian who has imputed righteousness is not really justified. This is where the Catholics twist the Protestant teaching of imputation. They say, oh no, when we baptize our converts, they aren't just counted justified, they are justified. More than implying that the Protestant imputation is not real justification, but is that the person is not really justified, but is counted as such.
The response of the reformers was, if the imputation were fictional, then when God declared us just, it would be a legal fiction. It would be a lie. And that would be a blemish on the character of God. But the point of the gospel is that the imputation is real. That God really laid my sins on Christ. And not only that, God really transferred the righteousness of Christ to me. And that there is a real union for those who are in Christ.
So it's pure semantics. Protestants speak of transference of justification through imputation, while Catholics speak of the pouring of justification into the soul by infusion, but it's the same darn thing. A sinner is magically transformed into a non-sinner, even if that sinner continues on in sin for the rest of his or her life. Sin becomes no longer sin. The Catholic priests will tell you to say a few Hail Marys and offer some other penance, and now your sins are white as snow. Your sin is no longer sin. The end result is still the same. The Christian never overcomes his or her sin, but relies either on a single act of contrition upon conversion and baptism with imputation of righteousness, or continual acts of contrition and sacramental activities designed to infuse one with righteousness. When you look at it in this light, the raging debate between the Catholic and the Protestant regarding imputation becomes almost comical, that is, if it weren't so tragic. Christianity actually turns Christ into a scapegoat for our sins, while at the same time claiming that this is what is meant by his being the Lamb that takes away the sins of the world.
Well, when we look at imputation, the concept of imputation is found frequently in the New Testament with the imagery like the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. How does he take away the sin of the world? How does the Lamb do it in the Old Testament? What's the symbolism? The priest puts his hands on the Lamb. Why? He's transferring symbolically the sins of the people to the animal that is to be sacrificed, or to the scapegoat who's to go out into the wilderness, and we'll look at that again later on. Jesus is said to bear our sins. He takes upon himself the sins of the world. The language there is a language of a quantitative act of transfer.
In their twisted version of Christ, the Passover lamb, they have the priest putting his hands on the lamb and transferring sins to the lamb, something that is not found anywhere in Scripture. The Passover lamb is not a sin offering. Neither is it a blood offering for atonement for sins. The Passover lamb is a memorial to the escape of Israel from Egypt, which is always a type and figure of our escape from the captivity of sin, not a transference of our sin to the Passover lamb.
Purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
So Christians literally lie about this and make things up as they go along, such as the priest putting his hands on the Passover lamb and transferring the sins of the people to it. The only time the sins of the people are put on a creature is the scapegoat. Christ is nowhere called the goat that takes away our sins. Nowhere is he called the scapegoat for our sins in Scripture. It's utter and complete fabrication. It's a legal fiction. Christians preach that their sins are cleaned as white as snow. This is what he is faithful and just to forgive our trespasses and cleanse us from all unrighteousness means to them. Not that their sins are no more and that they are living in the white robes of righteousness. No, it means that they continue in sins, but that those sins are magically clean. Their sin is no more sin. This they call liberty. Freedom to sin. They claim it's freedom from sin, but there's no belief of ceasing from sin. All the while they preach freedom, they quote Romans 7, where it says, I am carnal and sold under sin, and apply that to themselves, as we have seen in part 5. This is not liberty. It's captivity to sin. This is not being clean. This is being cleansed and then wallowing in the dirt again.
While they promise them liberty, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than, after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire.
Whether we are talking Roman Catholic, Protestant, or evangelical, Christianity is predicated on this idea that one remains sinful. Catholics can deny this all they want, but just look at their system of confession. The real big offenders in this, however, are the evangelicals, the so-called born again, who literally preach openly that now that they are born again, even though they walk in daily sins, it is not sin. If you quote 1 John chapter 3 to them, for example, where it says, he that abides in him does not commit sin, they will openly state that this is proof that, even though they sin every day as a born-again believer, it is not counted as sin. They don't commit sin because they are born again, even if they sin every day. Their sin is no sin. This is the bottom line. In the next part, we will show how they expand the law in an effort to nullify it completely, and how, according to Christianity, Christ taught that all human beings are naturally transgressors of the law just by being human.